art education necessary? As we just said at the start of what I was saying, that the most joyous part of our school memories are to do with art, some form of art. And in this, I will even call yoga an art. I will also call calisthenics an art. I will also call aerobics an art form. All these have given joy to our children and given it to ourselves. So now, why can this art education not be brought inside? So what does art education do specifically? It promotes hands-on experiential learning, where the students derive meaning and understanding from every learning experience. Art education makes learning joyful. This is extremely clear. Art education broadens the mind and enables the students to see multidisciplinary links between topics, subjects, and real life. Art education develops certain life skills, communication skills, reflection and inquiry skills, unconditioning of the mind leading to higher confidence levels, self-esteem, and appreciation for aesthetics and creativity. And children apply art-based inquiry, investigation, exploration, critical thinking, and creativity for deeper understanding of concepts. So this is to do with all art forms. Please don't think it is limited to any one art form. For example, in the routine way, we can just teach the children about perimeter and area and tell them the formula, and they just mug it up and they finish it off. When we're integrating art, we actually take them out. We do a little nukkad natak in the play field where they're dealing with the idea of the perimeter, which is the four sides of the play field, or the area, which is the area within the play field where they are actually performing their nukkad natak. And this can be shown through several ways, you know, telling them perform on the perimeter. So they all enter the perimeter and they start make a formation over there. Or you say, now use the area of the play field to show your play, to show your nukkad natak. So while doing the nukkad natak, the concept of area and perimeter becomes very, very clear to all the children. Likewise, when we teach the children about the process of election, we can either teach them from a textbook or again through a role play or maybe through art where they can draw, they can make, they can name their parties, they can give a name, they can make a symbol, they can have an election manifesto. So it helps them develop critical thinking, they develop confidence, their communication becomes better because after all they have to do prachar of their election program. So all of that is going to help them learn a particular topic in a more realistic, in a more fruitful, and hopefully in a more lifelong manner. So the first time art education was talked of was about 15 years ago as part of the NCF 2005. And it says, I've written it down very briefly here, art as a subject at all stages is recommended, covering all major spheres, music, dance, visual arts, theater, to promote aesthetic and personal awareness and the ability to express oneself in different forms. Art is brought squarely into the domain of the co-curricula, infusing all the subjects of learning with art while giving each an identity of their own at relevant stages. Children must develop skills and abilities in arts, visual and performing, and not treat these just as entertainment. Mm-hmm. Through the arts curriculum, children must be introduced to the rich and varied traditions of the country. And arts education should become both a tool and a subject taught as a compulsory subject in grade 10. So in between, if you remember 2009 onward, when we started with CCE, we had a greater integration of art, music, dance, theater, sculpture into the classrooms. And sadly, again, it went back into the recesses in some places where it was not really ingrained. Although while I say this, I'm aware that most of the people who are attending this presentation already are using, whether or not it is used as a tool for assessment. Now we flash forward to the NEP of 2020, which clearly says that art is to be integrated in every possible way. And the manual which was brought out last year shows you the way how. So experiential learning will include hands-on learning, arts integrated and sports integrated education, storytelling based pedagogy, among others, as standard pedagogy. And the curricular interaction of essential subjects, skills and capacities, where certain subjects, skills and capacities will be emphasized in school, such as scientific temper and evidence-based thinking, creativity and innovativeness, this is all part of art, sense of aesthetics and art, which is again art, oral and written communication, which can be, you know, making a nukkad natak or a full-fledged play or making an advertisement, health and nutrition, physical education, fitness, wellness and sports, collaboration and teamwork, problem solving and logical reasoning, vocational exposure and skills, and digital literacy. Bagless days will be encouraged throughout the year for various types of enrichment activities involving arts, quizzes, sports, and vocational crafts. How will this happen now? What is the roadmap ahead? Every school shall compulsorily reserve a minimum of 2 periods per week per class for art education. It should cover music, dance, visual arts, theater. It includes written, graphic, digital, and cinematic forms. It can include the culinary art form, as there is no better way to learn about the value of tasty and nutritious food, about crops and spices of India, and through the medium of learning to cook. Through the arts curriculum, students must be introduced to the rich and varied artistic traditions of the country. It is recommended that classes 6 to 8, that is upper primary, should be introduced to culinary arts. And arts must be integrated with the teaching and learning of all academic subjects from grade 1 to 12. AIL will continue as a pedagogical tool for classes 1 to 12, in addition to the arts education under core scholastic area as provided in the secondary school curriculum of the board. Reporting and implementation of art education AIL. This is very important. Please take a note of this. The board has prepared AE and AIL portal for reporting of the implementation of art education and art integrated learning. The schools are required to upload data of the art education and art integrated learning projects of students in the AE and AIL portal at this link, for enabling students of class 10 and 12 to appear in the board exam. Schools may follow the below mentioned steps for uploading the data. This is already given in your documents also, but I'll just read it out for you. The required data regarding implementation of AE up to class 10 and art integrated project up to class 10, implementation of AIL up to class 12 are to be uploaded by the school to enable it to download the admit cards for class 10 and 12 exams of the board. The report format of data of submission is available in Annexure 3. It's all in the AIL manual, if you look at it. Now, why is this being done? What is the objective? What is the outcome that is being looked at? Firstly, to provide students with the broadest opportunities to explore unique and unexpected creative, intellectual, and vocational pathways. We accept that not all children learn well through a textbook. We all accept that just a lecture method like what I'm doing now is not the nicest way to teach. And I think teachers who use other ways of teaching always end up having a bigger fan following and having students actually loving their subjects and not just learning it because there has to be a test to be appeared for. So I think the opportunities it provides the children are very unique and very special. The second objective is, of course, it assists learners to use artistic and aesthetic sensibility in day-to-day life situations. I think all of us agree that we see art everywhere.
From our side, we have said that stand for the national anthem.
Somebody's dictating a letter.
Now it is up to the audience. From our side, we have told them to stand. Now it is up to the audience.
Malini ma'am, please help.
Thanks, very true.
One miss, just thanks. Very true. Just hit my call. Please mute your mic.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much, Meenakshi ma'am. So I think we all accept that we see art everywhere. I mean, we participate in an artistic activity from the time we wake up. All of us go to school, we dress up in a certain way. We match our accessories with what we are wearing. For me, that is art. The way a student, even when they're in uniform, how nicely they present themselves in uniform is also an artistic expression, according to me. How we do up our homes, how are we training our children, that how should a class look like? What should a softboard in the class look like? What should your home look like? How should your room look like, for example? What should your desk look like? Some children, I believe parents complain, I have very messy desks. So to bring that aesthetic sensibility in them, that they should be able to make every part of their life as artistic as possible, because with art comes beauty. The third objective is, of course, enable learners to achieve a balanced growth as social beings in tune with the environment through various aspects of art. Now, when we talk about this, we're actually talking a lot about what they study in geography. So when instead of making a child mug up what grows in a certain place, if you just show them the artifacts of that place, that's enough to tell them what grows there and how it grows and what is done to it. Take, for example, the Northeast. You know, there is such a abundance of bamboo over there that you have every possible artifact made out of bamboo. You have furniture made out of bamboo. You have baskets made out of bamboo. You have food made out of bamboo. So an appreciation of linking what grows where, what are the resources available where, with what is being made over there, without mugging up, by just appreciating what is happening over there. Fourth and last, create an approach to teaching in which students construct and demonstrate understanding through various art forms. Now, how does a child construct this knowledge? If you just randomly play some music in your class and you ask them to construct the knowledge of why something is sung in a certain place, why is it sung in a certain way, what is it showing you about the social and political system of that place, I think this is how children learn best. So the four objectives of art education and art integrated learning, in fact, are mentioned here. What, therefore, are the sources of art education? Now, with the NEP clearly talking about localizing and creating a dimension of regional appreciations, where children should not feel away from where they are. So the ethos of a region, the folk dance of the region. While they are dancing that folk dance, what are they wearing and why are they wearing it? The local art or the folk art. Why is a certain kind of art made more famous than the other? What are the folk traditions? What happens in a family in a particular region? What is the folk theater of that place? What is the local and the folk music? Now, all this becomes your source for art teaching of a particular area. And while teaching art of that area, what we are doing is we are creating respect, harmony, deeper understanding of each other's traditions and culture. And the best thing is that in every area that you are, schools can contact local artists, dancers, musicians, theater people, and involve them in this activity, either through Spikmeke or on your own. You are well aware that at this moment, and in fact, let's not blame Corona, for the longest time ever, it was only Spikmeke which was helping local regional artists. Most artists are living on the fringes of poverty, whether it's a weaver, whether it's a potter, whether it's somebody who's making leather goods. They are very poor, and most of the money is being taken by intermediaries. By the time it reaches us, it's exorbitantly priced. But for the poor producer of that, the poor artisan, he's still living in the fringe of poverty. So as very awakened schools, can we not use this source of teaching of art and provide benefit even to the people who are participants of this art, who are masters of this art? The basic principles of integration, therefore, are inclusive. You do not exclude any child. Child with special needs is able to participate in most art forms, depending on their level of disability or ability. All art integration has to be reflective. As teachers, we need to reflect that if we are teaching this particular topic, what art form can I use? So I am a teacher of history, for example, and I was using art in my classes much before art was spoken about. And I'll give you an example. So I used to choose, which art form am I using when? So when I was teaching class 5 social studies, for example, I would allow my class, with the permission of the principal, that can they all come dressed in the state where they belong. So I could have a child coming in a mekhla chadar, I could have a child coming in a ghagra, I could have a child coming in a 9-yard sari. So it helped me reflect, it made the children reflect of why, what is happening in which state. As a history teacher, again, I would choose what art form I would use. So if I'm teaching, for example, when I was teaching Bhakti and Sufi, I had to reflect. I can't use art, you know, visual art for that. I could use dance, but I found that music was a better representation because most Bhakti and Sufi saints wrote the most beautiful bhajans and nazams of that time. So I used to carry my huge, we used to have those big sized in the 80s, we had those big sized cassette players. I would carry it into my class and spend a whole 40 minute period in playing that music. So perhaps I would be at that in that period criticized for wasting a period. But for me, it was not a waste because it gave the children a deeper understanding of Bhakti and Sufi. Without me going into the tenets of this is Bhakti and that is Sufi, by the music and by the words of that song, they would understand the essence of it. All art integration has to be experiential. The children have to do it with their hand. Unless they use their hand or their heart or their head, it is not going to be effective. Only as a demonstrative activity, it is not going to work out. Integration obviously means transdisciplinary because while I'm teaching history, for example, and I'm teaching them Bhakti and Sufi, I am bringing in music over there. Supposing I give them a music piece and I ask them to compose a song on that, maths will come in because they will have to study the meter. What is the meter of the song and what words will fit in over there? You know, what we call tukbandi. It has to also be decompartmentalized. So all forms will come together. So like the NEP also talks about culinary arts and the NCF also talked about it. I'll give you a small example of something as elementary as what we call cooking without fire. And we talk about maybe making a salad. So when we are making a salad, it becomes an activity of science because we are going to use, it has to be a balanced diet. It has to have vitamin, it has to have protein, it has to have a certain amount of fiber. It must have minerals. It must have some element of carbohydrate, if not too much. We immediately bring in some maths because you have to measure how much of what you're going to use. You'll bring in art because you will have to present it beautifully for people to want to eat it. Otherwise, it'll look just like nothing on earth. So we are bringing in immediately a lot of dimensions without compartmentalizing it. Now this was maths and this was science and this was the art bit. It all comes together. Problem solving, especially when we take to social sciences or sciences, a lot of issues of the sciences get solved when you're talking in terms of doing the same exercise as a rap song, doing the same learning as a Nukkad Natak maybe. And all these activities, as you can see, will necessarily bring in collaboration because individual children cannot be asked to do something individually. They can't sort of choreograph a full dance or make a salad on their own. So there will be a collaboration. There will be even that issue of, you know, who will get what. So I think these principles, if they are kept in mind, the integration of arts into the curriculum becomes that much more meaningful, that much more easy. What is this? Why have I got this yellow thing in the middle of my page? It's gone. Now I'm coming to a couple of activities to make it more real and to make it more, doable, so to say. So in the really small classes, for example, in classes 1 and 2, where we are doing very basic maths. So color the thickest book red. This is a visual exercise. Whichever is the thickest book, they are going to use it as red. Color the thinnest book green. It's an activity. Now, in the next shelf, there are some vases lying. Draw the green dots on the biggest vase. And now put a flower with 2 leaves in this vase. So you're checking also their listening skill and how well they are reading. Are they comprehending what we are telling them? And the third exercise was color the shortest bottle or bottles red. I made the teacher write bottles because according to me, 2 of these are red, not 1, are the shortest ones. Again, an exercise in observation where we are going to ask the child to observe all these shoes are looking very similar when we are looking at them, but they're not the same. You have to find the pattern very carefully and then color the identical pairs with the same colors. So it's an exercise in really teaching the children micro-observation. Integrating visual arts with science. This is something which I gave an example of this. We can talk to the children about healthy food habits, vegetables and fruits, proteins, carbs and fatty food. And now they are asked to draw their favorite food on this picnic plate that they have. and they can have some. So art is coming in alive here. So clearly, we're not allowing the children to make bottles of cold drinks over here or packets of chips. So if we ingrain these good habits at a young age, we hope and we presume that learning will be more long-lasting, perhaps, and more fun for them. Integrating art with numbers, counting, and understanding shapes. This is for junior school, where we gave them these dots, just a series of dots, and we asked them to join them in to form any pattern. If you've read the art integration manual, you will also notice that states have been linked together. I hope you're aware of that. So, like I noticed that UP was linked with Meghalaya and Arunachal Pradesh. So, Arunachal Pradesh will learn about the art forms, all art forms, dance, music, visual art, theater, everything of UP. And likewise, UP will learn it for Arunachal Pradesh and Meghalaya. For Haryana, where my school is, we have been linked to Telangana. And this kind of rangoli is made in Telangana. So, we linked the state along with the learning of maths. Now, this is an exercise in simple fractions done very artistically. This is Mondrian artwork examples where the children used pen, pencil, paper, and red, blue, black, yellow marker pens. And they were asked to find fractions within this framework. So obviously the element of maths comes over here. So in this circle, for example, 1/4 of the circle is red, 3/4 is blue. Likewise for this triangle, half the triangle is blue, half is white. And if you take away that circle, then they calculate accordingly, I suppose. For 6 to 8, integrating visual arts with numbers, counting, and understanding shapes. Here, this was an activity which was very popular with the children. And they, in fact, we did this online with them. So they made a paper pinwheel, which is called the Newton disc or the disappearing color disc. Wind is the form of energy which helps the pinwheel to rotate. And the rotating disc, which is made of different colors, appears to be white. And this was doable even online, where the teacher demonstrated. Then the children all made it. And they had it all over their balconies. And they sent pictures to us. Again, AIL for middle school, where we did a puppet making exercise. So these kind of puppets, they're made out of leather. And they're called Tholu Bommalata. I'm sure I'm pronouncing it wrong. And they are used as folk theater means of narrating stories from the Ramayana Mahabharata and local folk tales in Telangana. And we asked all our students to make it not out of leather, but out of waste paper. So all this is newspapers which have been used, and they have all been colored and painted to make it look like a real puppet. And all these puppets have moving parts. You know, their arms move, their legs move. They are based on hinges. Can you see over here in this one? These are all hinged. So everything can move. So we use these actually even within the classroom, made of, in the art period, linked it to Telangana, but was used in a variety of ways by the language teachers, where they did role play, by the social science teachers, when they were teaching them about Mahabharata and Ramayana. So the limitation of a puppet is not limited to only being a puppet. The puppet can be used as creatively as possible, depending completely on the creativity of the teacher who's teaching. This is a very interesting slide, which I borrowed from our friend, Anita Makkar, ma'am. I don't know if she's in the meeting today or not. This has been done by her school, HDFC school, and they've linked haiku and chemistry. So haiku, if you know, is a Japanese poetry style where the first 5 syllables are in the first line, 7 syllables in the second line, and 5 syllables again in the last line. And she's given 3 examples here, and I took her permission to use this slide, where magnesium, as the children have written this, child of aging stars, however brightly you burn, they will never return. Lithium, lighter than water, empower my phone, my car, banish depression. Nitrogen, forever recycling from air to soil, roots, crops, us, exercise addict. So any child who's written this, any child who's learned this way, will never forget it. We have in fact have had children doing the periodical table in the form of a rap song. And it sounded quite wonderful for me, who is not a science person. And that particular batch will not, I think, ever forget the periodic table then. How do we integrate art in the languages? And when I say languages, I'm talking about all English, Hindi, Sanskrit, foreign languages in the visual and performing arts. So the first way we did for senior school was producing, designing an advertisement. So based on this, what could the seller be selling? You know, then create a jingle and an advertisement with the picture clue. So nowadays, if you notice, a lot of very unusual ads are made. It begins with something and it ends up with something else. You think that this is being sold and in the end, you find that it was something quite different. So it's the creativity which comes into play over here while using art as a means to communicate. This is an exercise in micrography where children place the picture of a famous person and put a butter paper on top or a tracing paper on top, and they write about the person using the shadings. So if you make it big, this is all about Mother Teresa. It says Blessed Teresa of Calcutta, commonly known as Mother Teresa, was a Roman Catholic religious sister and missionary. Can you see this? Likewise about Gandhiji. You know, so it's all written down. The child is learning while creating a work of art. And once it's done, the portrait of the famous person just comes alive without having to sketch. So a person who says, I can't sketch, I can't do art, can do this and create a piece of art. Because it's simple. You're just putting a tracing paper on a picture and you're writing about that person. And this obviously will develop creativity, innovation, confidence, sensitivity, all of that, and while learning. Integrating visual arts with maths and science in the senior classes. Here we're talking about tessellations in nature. So whether you see any pattern in nature, you encourage children to go out and find these patterns. Don't give it to them. You know, anything which is given is usually forgotten. If they find it on their own, if they find this pattern on their own, it becomes more real and more tangible for them.
So meeting join kar lo.
Somebody's again got their mic off. Okay. Art integration in social science now. Like I spoke about civics. In civics, use of role play and street plays, creating comics and cartoons. We have made cartoons and comics for a number of historical events, which have become very popular because it's got all the information. But just because it's done visually and it's done by the children, it has become easy for them to learn. In history, like I said, the use of music, dance, theater, art, sculpture, and painting. And in geography, the music and dance of a region, handicrafts of a region, which are based on a raw material. I gave that example in the beginning. Why a certain region has a certain kind of music or has a certain kind of dress or has a certain kind of art and craft. It tells a lot to a child. I'll give you another example, which I used again many, many years ago when I was teaching in middle school. I think it was in the early mid 80s, where we were teaching the children about early man. And you know, some of these topics can be very unreal for a child because they've not been really exposed to primitive life as such. So when I was teaching them, when I was going to teach them, I first told them that imagine that your uniform is just your body. So you're not wearing anything. And I had taken a lot of pieces of old newspaper cut in different sizes. I said, these are all the leaves that you have here. Now cover yourself up. Right now you're wearing nothing. So I cannot recreate for you. Now this is almost 30 years ago, but I cannot explain to you how much fun the children had while picking up different, and I was naughty. I kept some really small leaves also. So they asked me, ma'am, how do we stitch this together? I said, you imagine, there's no stapler over there. Here, there's a stapler, but what would early man have done? From them, it came that he used twigs to piece these together. So they almost made clothes, like a basic loincloth, which early man wore. They made something like that just to cover themselves. Now, to teach them about cave paintings, for example, I asked them, I said, what do you think early man would be wanting to paint? We won't want to paint Mona Lisa. He doesn't have time. He doesn't know how to do that. So they themselves said, man, he must be painting something exciting which happens in his life. For him, for his life, probably the most exciting thing was catching a big animal, because then they could get to eat good food for a long, long time. And how will he paint? Does he have paint brushes? So again, this was a slightly longer exercise, and I had to borrow a period from one of my friends who was a physics teacher. We had a combined class, and I just upturned all the desks and chairs. I mean, I turned the chairs upside down, and I asked them to all bring sheets, and we covered that, and each of those modules became a cave. And I pushed 4 children inside each cave, and I asked them, now paint. They said, ma'am, it's too dark. I said, yeah, exactly. The cave is also dark. Now what? What will you do? But you have to paint, because now you're free. You want to do something creative. You can't just sit there. They all made pencil, you know, the pencil matchstick figures, much like what early man had made. So without having to teach them, I was able to teach them only by making them experience what life would have been like. Life was difficult. Life was dark. You had to hunt for food. You didn't have clothes. When it was very cold, you had to build fire because the cave was all cold. So it was at that time, Nukkad Natak was not such a done thing. But in this role playing and in this recreating, I think a lot of fun and a lot of learning happened. This is an origami projectile motion activity which was done in class 9 and 10, where the students, again, this was done at home. And the students were asked to make their own paper planes using, again, because we're constantly talking about not wasting paper, using old magazines or old newspapers. And then they measured their distance depending on the size of the airplane that they had made or the weight. If it was a heavy magazine paper, it probably didn't fly too far. If it was handmade paper, it didn't fly at all because that's very heavy. If it's a newspaper, it did fly. So all of that, the thrust, the lift, the drag, the gravity, and how it affects the flights was recorded by the children and shared with the teacher. Integrating traditional Indian textiles with economics and social science. Again, this is something which we brought in economics in, because how is the artisan going to survive if we are not aware of the kind of work that he is doing? So it so happens that right now Pochampalli Ikat is also very fashionable. And it is a traditional textile of Telangana. So we made them do this kind of work while explaining that this is done by weaving, not simply by painting. So through this, then we asked them to collect research and find out about traditional textiles of the rest of the country. There is such a rich repository of textiles in our country. If we start looking and we start researching about each, I don't think there's enough time in one lifetime. But if everybody gets together collaboratively and finds out about even one and teaches each other, I think it's that much more fun. Again, a negative painting technique integrating physics, that is the concept of light with painting. This was done by the senior children of 11th and 12th and by the art students. To be honest, this is not done by all of them, but the science students who are doing art also produced this work of art. This is something else we did in English in languages. For every poem that the children have done, we asked them to paint something. So you can see something here in German also. This is something that they had read, and then they had to make a painting about it. Or they were asked to write something based on a particular painting that was given. Again, dramatization and role play of prose and poetry, setting a poem to music, bringing in art into the classroom. So with this, I come to an end to my presentation, and I'm right on time because now we have 15 minutes of question answers. And like I've said in this Venn diagram, that arts will lend themselves to theater, music, visual arts, and dance, and will promote communication, creativity, choice, and civilization, an appreciation of our civilization and how we've reached where we have reached. I hope that made some sense.
Yes. That was really beautiful. Thank you so much. Aditi, I think we are bombarded with questions. I am sure Meenakshi and Asha would be ready, and you better arm yourself.
I hope I'm ready. They are ready. I hope I'm ready to answer. Yes.
Yes.
Aditi, the first and foremost question, which is a very common question coming to you from most of the teachers, is that could you please share a few art integration stories, very successful stories, you know? You may like to brief us with one of these successful stories.
So maybe the one that I told you about, the early man, was a very fun, successful story. All these examples that I've shared, except for the haiku one, which has come from Anita Makkar ma'am's school, these are all done in my school and they're all successful. I can preempt a question. Most teachers are worried, most principals are worried that it will slow down the curriculum transaction. I'm sure that question has come as well.
Yes, it is there.
Let me reassure you, it doesn't slow down. It adds to the learning experience. So I think one of my most successful stories is the one about the early man. What they did just now, during the Corona times, they've created a full comic. I can share that in a PowerPoint later on, perhaps. There were some cartoons, I don't know if you noticed, can I show you those again? I'll just show you. There were some cartoons with Corona, because that's the most topical. That's what they're living through right now. You know, this thing in German, I think, is about Corona. Okay. Then there is one over here. This one. Can you see this? I've made it big. The COVID-19 outbreak. So how do you measure success? I want to understand that. You know, for me, success is if the child is enjoyed and has done some learning as well. I cannot give it marks. I cannot measure it with any measurable goal. But if the children have enjoyed the activity and if some learning has happened, I think that is my measure of success. Asha, I hope that answers the question.
Well, Aditi, yes, beautifully answered. But, you know, one thing which is coming now into my mind is that infusing art into the curriculum is a highly innovative approach. And a teacher has to keep her thinking caps on all the time. So according to you, since you have mastered the subject, according to you, what are the five qualities which a teacher should have in her to introduce with passion the art integration, you know, since it is an it's a kind of an approach which I don't think so anybody, any teacher can do it very easily. You know.
So I'll tell you, Asha, that's a very nice question. And let me first correct you. I have not mastered it. I'm a learner still. We've just started it about a year ago. But I will share with you what we are doing, what is working. If I expect a teacher to find by herself what aspect of art she will integrate, it will be a problem. So the first thing which we teach our children is what we are learning, that is collaboration. So all our meetings are collaborative, where the art teachers, there are lots of them, will sit in with the departmental meetings. So there is first the element of collaboration where the physics teacher will say that this is what we have to teach. Now, what will it lend itself to? Can it be linked to art or music? Or should we do theater? Or should we do a rap song? And you come to a conclusion as to what module can come in what aspect of art. So first, collaboration. Second, willingness to learn. We have not been taught this way. Let's be very honest. This is not how we were taught. So very often we tend to sort of slide back into the way we were taught. But this is not the kind of child we were either. Today's child is much more creative than what we were. So if the child is different, if the entire diaspora is different, we have to also change. So the willingness to change. Third, the will to experiment and fail. Because not everything will be successful. If we go in with a mindset that we have to succeed, it's a problem. And that's what is a problem. I feel even in today's generation, we are gearing up our children only for success and achievement, not so much for failure. So there is no harm in trying an experiment which is based on art, failing and talking to the children. If it failed, no problem, we'll try something else. And then try and analyze why it failed. And the fourth, most important one, is involving the children in every aspect of this. You cannot say, I'm going to sing and this is Sufi movement for you. I'm sorry. Everybody will sing. Sing Besura doesn't matter, but sing. So participation, collaboration, patience, and the will to fail, experiment and fail, I think are the four most important dimensions for me for introducing art into the curriculum.
Thank you, Aditi. Well said.
Aditi, may I just come in? I think the NEP now talks about interdisciplinary education for teachers, which means, you know, there is going to be a multifaceted teacher at the end of it. Right now, we are all limited by our subjects and we feel we are specialists. Yeah. We cannot go beyond. Perhaps, you know, this multidimensional aspect to a teacher would bring in a lot more creativity than what we have.
Absolutely, currently. Malini. Absolutely. And the very fact that this board is talking about, both the boards apparently are talking about reducing the curriculum effectively so that the teacher is not burdened with the thought of we have to do so much and we have to do so much of integration. So suitable rationalization of the curriculum to be able to include every aspect of culture and art that we can bring in. Asha, any more?
Yes, Aditi, I personally feel that what will be the role of the art teacher in the school at this point of time, you know, because the art teacher cannot have a knowledge of all the languages and for that matter, sciences and mathematics. They come with a degree of Bachelor of Fine Arts. So what kind of pedagogical tools are they to be trained for?
So that's what I was saying, that the collaboration has to happen when two people meet. And each becomes each other's strength and obliterates the weaknesses. So the history teacher does not know dance. The dance teacher doesn't know history. So the history teacher in the departmental meeting talks about it. This is what I'm going to be doing. How can I teach it? So the theory teacher says, oh, we can do it through theater. It will be good fun. Aise karwa sakte hain. The art teacher says, no, you can do it through this also. So they are supporting each other and helping build each other's skills. So the music teacher will also come in. When we talk about art, it's not just art. It's the art, music, dance, theater, and even sports coming in. You know, there was so much of activity around the PEG cards, which was limited to the junior school only. Now bringing it into the middle school. And of course, as Malini said very rightly, retraining the teacher. Until we retrain and we accept that right now we are like incomplete beings. I only know history. I must know a little bit of maths. I need to know a little bit of dance and music to be able to bring that into my classroom. So the collaboration between these departments will become much deeper, I feel, much more meaningful, and both will learn from each other. So the art teacher may not know, but the moment they were talking about this, you know, why you're a physics teacher, am I right? Why the multitude of colors becomes colorless after a while. Immediately the idea of the pinwheel came from the art teacher and she helped them make it. So they are growing together, I would say, you know.
Yeah, Meenakshi, if you're there,
and yeah.
Meenakshi jumps in. I have Geeta Gangwani saying, are there any standardized rubrics of assessment for this group integrated activity?
Not yet. Not yet.
We need to develop it ourselves.
We have to find it ourselves. But no, but we will get a template. We will get some kind of a guidance from CBSE once we know. About the rationalized curriculum, once we know exactly what is being removed and what is being added and how it is to be assessed. And while I'm saying this, let me also quickly clarify that not all topics, not all modules lend themselves to art integration. Let's understand that. Zabardasti nahi karna hai, ki to karna hai, to let we have to do something. It may not lend itself. So just teach it the way it was taught. But that will be only... According to what I have understood, that will be only one or two modules in the entire year. Everything else is being reworked and redesigned in such a way that it will have some element of, I'm calling it joy. I don't want to call it art anymore. There will be joy in the class. Meenakshi?
Yes, one question is continuously coming that teachers are finding it difficult to integrate art in the senior and the secondary classes. They are saying that we are doing it all in the primary classes, but how to integrate in senior and senior secondary is an issue. And specifically maths, they are asking.
No, so like I'm saying, in the maths activity also, they have to find some element of, I believe children are more scared of integration. They're terrified of integration. So why not make a rap song out of it? Why not have the elements of integration as role plays? Who's doing what? So I think if you put your head down to it, they will find a way. You know, the senior school children and senior school teachers tend to think differently. They are all geared up towards the board exam. Now, if you come to know that in 2023, the board exam will look different from what it is looking now, and you will not only be asked to, but you will be expected to teach the subjects in a more holistic way, we have to do it. There are problems. Of course, this is a huge challenge. There are schools which run on two art teachers. How will the two art teachers provide for art ka gyan across? So the schools have to rethink. There will be, and luckily, thanks to Google Baba, there is enough information. We have found most of our fun activities on Google. There is a specific site called Pinterest. I think most of you know about it. Yes. Pinterest has a lot of interesting ideas with regard to science, math, senior, junior, middle, college, which can be used.
Okay, Aditi, these days all the schools are struggling. I mean, especially during the COVID times, all schools are struggling that how to do the term one assessments. So can you suggest something that term one assessments are done, art is integrated, and the marks are ready, the genuine ones without cheating element into the attempts?
Okay, so this is a very complicated question because I have a basic problem with this element of mistrust that we have. We have grown up in an environment of mistrust and we continue to perpetuate it. Why do we think our children will cheat? How will they think? Why do we presume that? Why can your question not be based in such a way that the child either has understood and will answer or will not be able to answer? Can we not create such questions? I'm giving you a personal example. In way back in DPS Arkepuram, I gave my children the happiest news one day that I'm going to give them an open book test. Their joy knew no bounds. I can't tell you how happy they were. But the question paper, when they saw, they said, ma'am, what are you saying? I said, if you've listened to me, you know the answer. If you've not listened, book mein nahi hai. Book mein hai, but not in those many words. So can we not be innovative in our questioning? Can we not be more innovative in our teaching learning, in our entire pedagogical approach? And I think the first term exams, we have to do online. There's no question of it. So why not use art? So when a teacher is taking an online class, why can she not use a puppet while teaching and while asking the children, okay, raise your puppet and answer instead of raising your hand? We did this feelings exercise. Okay, I'll share this with you also. We did a feelings exercise. So we have a feelometer, you know, where it says not feeling too good, feeling okay, feeling a little stressed out, feeling happy, feeling ecstatic. So it goes from red to yellow to green. And then we had this little hand puppet made out of a moza, purana moza. This was in middle school. And we made the child say, how is your puppet feeling? So you were immediately, we know it's a child's own feelings, but when you are transferring his feelings onto a puppet, I felt the children were much more honest. They talked about that my puppet was a little upset. There was a lot of noise coming from the downstairs neighbors. They were having a fight. So things which our children try to bury under the sand sometimes come out in these ways. So this is art. And I mean, how you wish to assess it is completely up to every school. There's autonomy there.
With the data.
Yeah.
Meenakshi, are you there?
Yeah, I am there, but I can't hear Aditi.
Huh?
Okay, Aditi, I think that was an extremely, informative session.
Malini, so, there is one more question.
There are more questions. Okay. Let me get you in quickly with those questions. Yeah.
It is, how do we get the children collaborate and do group work from home, especially when few of them are not even able to attend online classes? And so when there is another one, can we make the children prepare a PPT on a topic as part of art integration?
How are you integrating art if the child is making a PPT? If you are asking them to, for example, depict the coronavirus through a worldly painting, then you're integrating art. If you're asking them to represent a poem in Hindi, Sanskrit, or English or German through a Madhubani painting, that is integration of art. Yes, certainly. It is there. They know what a worldly painting or a Madhubani looks like, and they are interpreting it in their own way. But asking me a question about the absence of devices is not something I can answer, because this is an issue which is being sort of talked about for the past 4 months. So in the absence of a device, if a child cannot participate in a class, then obviously he can't be part of an art integration thing. But what we did, I'll share with you as part of art integration. We had a poem being set to music by one of the senior students, and it was a slightly easy poem. So we asked the children of 7th, 8th to recite it. And they've all recited just 2-3 lines of it. And then one of the senior children has sort of put it together. So the first line is sung by child 1, second side line is sung by child 2, third is by child 3. And when you see it together, you see about 40 children reciting those 40 lines, all differently. So it's collaborative in a sense, because you all have been given a certain meter, a certain pitch, AC pitch pe gana hai. In fact, I don't know, some of you may have seen way back when the lockdown just started, me and my leadership team did a ridiculous dance on Happy. And it was strung together. It was that time we were not really thinking about art. I just wanted them to laugh a little bit, because we were all very stressed out.
We'll request Sapna Lamba to kindly mute herself, please. Sapna Lamba, we'll request
she's muted.
You to
she's
mute
muted
yourself.
Herself. She's muted herself. Thanks. So I hope I'm coming across the children. So okay, I'll share one more thing. I run a school for the underprivileged children. Okay. And I feel really bad because not all of them have devices. We have managed to get, for almost 78% of them, we've managed to get devices through parents and through help from some corporates. We are able to send them lessons. And day before yesterday, as part of the Gandagi Hatao, we've got them to paint the outside walls of our government school that we have adopted in Gurgaon. So for me, that became an activity of art. It became an activity of understanding, of empathy, everything together, because now they are representing the various forms of art on that wall. If I can just share a couple of pictures with you. Here they are. They're all wearing masks. I can show it to you over here. Is it visible?
Yes, it is.
It is.
Yeah.
And it's the door to happiness that they are painting.
Absolutely. Actually, to cleanliness.
Yeah. Cleanliness, yes.
This is what the wall looks like now.
Very nice.
It's in continuation. So it's collaboration. And these are the children from the poorest homes. They do not have 2 meals a day. So we gave them the paint. We gave them the idea. But the expression and the articulation was completely theirs.
Yeah, and you know, there is a huge demand of the PPT be shared and the YouTube link also be.
PPT I'll send to Malini, she can share it. I have no problem.
Yeah.
It will be on my NPSC website.
Yes, I have also put it up on the chat, saying the recording would be available in our NPSC YouTube channel.
Don't fall to bakwas.
Deepti ma'am, if you can mute yourself, please. Yeah. So, Asha, Meenakshi, is there something more?
No, I think we have covered all the questions more or less.
Oh, that's nice. I think that was a big volley of questions that Aditi managed to answer.
A lot of praises, very refreshing, wonderful evening. And
thank you.
It's all over.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
So, Asha, may I please request you?
Once again, good evening to the August gathering present for the webinar on articulating the curriculum art integration. I would like to use this forum to say that in a race to succeed in core academic subjects, art is often sidelined. However, with this paradigm shift that supports the power of visualization, multidisciplinary learning, and respect for culture and heritage, art-integrated syllabus has taken a center stage. In order to get positive learning outcomes, one needs to step outside the limited world of textbooks. And armed with a flexible examination system, integration of culinary arts, performing and visual arts with core subjects like mathematics, sciences, social sciences, languages, etc., it has opened up the fresh vistas for the youngsters and proves to be a breath of fresh air in a system that has been needing a change for several years. And during such testing times when the pandemic has been raging on incessantly, CBSE's initiative to integrate the art-based learning has provided to be the key to enhance the learning outcomes and make education more productive in the long run. So we at the NPSC India are grateful to Ms. Aditi, Principal DPS Gurugram, for providing her valuable insights on today's topic and lending substance to this interaction by her knowledge and thoughts. We are also deeply indebted to Meenakshi Kushwaha, Principal Birla Vidya Niketan, for fielding all the questions which have been posed by the participants and Aditi addressing them with credible clarity and elan. And my vote of thanks obviously remains incomplete if I do not thank the Secretary NPSC and Chairperson NPSC for providing a wonderful platform to augment and encourage excellence in the field of education. We, the core team, thank you all for joining us in this webinar, and we look forward to more such fruitful exchange of ideas, information, and viewpoints. Stay safe, stay healthy. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Asha. The program cannot get over without me saying a heartfelt thank you to you for proposing the vote of thanks, and a word to all the participants. Tomorrow is another exciting day, and I want to tell you that we have the teacher empowerment series starting parallelly tomorrow. While the NEP series is on the way, in progress, we've started the teacher empowerment series, and tomorrow is the first webinar on mathematics. So I'll be sending the poster and the link. The poster has already been sent to you. The mail link will come to you tomorrow. We have five teachers presenting the best practices, both using digital and other tools to enhance learning in mathematics. So looking forward to meeting you all again. And you must carry this message for the mathematics teachers of your school, please. So thank you once again, Aditi, Meenakshi, Asha, and all our participants for staying with us this late. Thank you. And till we meet again tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. It was really nice.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Aditi, ma'am.
It
was so nice.
Thank you, Aditi, ma'am.
And ma'am, can we make a group in which we can share our activities so that it will be beneficial for everybody?
We can definitely do that, and we'll look at it. You may also post it at the NPSC meeting address.
Exactly.
That would also help. Yes?
Because, ma'am, we need to share, and it will be helpful for everybody.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Ashish ji, we will end the meeting, please.